Good morning, and thank you all for tuning in to the NFC Virtual Worship Experience. At this time, would you all please click that share button so that others will join in with us. Happy birthday to everyone celebrating a birthday this month. If you're celebrating a birthday, please comment your birthday below so we can show you some birthday love. Again, happy birthday, everyone. The iGrove Youth Ministry meet via Zoom every Sunday night at 8 p.m. with Minister Dewberry. Parents, please be sure to encourage your children to join in with Minister Dewberry so that they can stay connected and know what's going on with the youth ministry. Do you ever wish you had a reset button? Well, guess what? You do. It's called prayer. Join us tomorrow night at 6 p.m. for the weekly NMC prayer call for your reset. Prayer is the one way to get that reset for your week. So be sure to set your reminder to join us tomorrow night at 6 p.m. for the weekly prayer call. Have you tuned in to Tuesday Talks with Pastor Q yet? If not, this Tuesday at 6 p.m. via Facebook, Facebook will be the perfect opportunity to get a brief moment of empowerment from Pastor Baker. Again, tune in this Tuesday as well as every Tuesday at 6 p.m. for Tuesday Talks with Pastor Q. As always, thank you all for joining in to the NMC Virtual Worship Experience. We thank you all for your support. May the word that goes forth this morning be a blessing to you all. Have a great day.
Good morning. Are y'all ready to praise and lift up the name of Jesus? Listen, I'm ready. I hope you're ready. Come on and clap your hands this morning. Get in a grateful place. Just think about all the wonderful things that God has done, but not just what he's done, but for who he is. So we're going to lift up a praise this morning, y'all. Let's go. Here we go. Listen. Oh, Lord, we praise you. 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 Everybody say, oh, Lord, we praise you. It's simple, y'all. Oh, Lord, we praise you. Oh, Lord, we praise you. Oh, Lord, we praise you. Listen, I was thinking the other day about the joy that came my way. How you took away my crown and all the things that had me bound. I thought about all those times that I was walking around. In a daze, today I stand before you with nothing but praise. Oh, Lord, we praise you. Oh, Lord, we praise you. Everybody say, oh, Lord, we praise you. Oh, Lord, we praise you. Take us higher. Oh, Lord, we praise you. Oh, Lord, we praise you. Everybody say, oh, Lord, we praise you. Oh, Lord, we praise you. Take it higher. Oh, Lord, we praise you. Oh, Lord, we praise you. Yes, we do, Lord. Oh, Lord, we praise you. Oh, Lord, we praise you. Listen, I was thinking the other day about the joy came my way. How you took away my crown and all the things that had me down. I thought about all those times that I was walking around in days. And today I stand before you with nothing but praise. Oh, Lord, we praise you. 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 Hallelujah. 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 We give you the praise. We give you the glory. We give you the honor. We bless your name this morning. Because you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor. And so we take ourselves out of the way. And we say, I give myself away. This song simply is a sign of us surrendering.
Hallelujah, God. Thank you, Lord. It says, I give myself away. Lift it up if you know it. Thank you, Jesus. I give myself away so you can use me. I give myself away. I give myself away so you can use me. Here I am. Here I stand. Lord, my life is in your hands. Lord, I'm longing to see your desire revealed in me. I give myself away. Let's surrender this morning, our all, y'all. I give myself away so you can use me. I give myself away. I make myself available to you. I give myself away so you can use me. So here I am. Here I stand, and Lord, my life is in your hands. Lord, I'm longing to see your desire revealed in me. I give myself away. Give myself away so you can use me. I give myself away. Here I am, Lord. I give myself away so you can use me. You can use me. Your hands, to you I belong. I give myself to you. My life is not my own, to you I belong. Yeah, I give myself to you. Come on, let's sing it together. Life is not my own, to you I belong. I give myself to you. My life is not my own, yeah, to you I belong. I give myself to you. I give myself away. Oh, I give myself away so you can use me. I give myself away. I give myself away so you. And I surrender all. I surrender all to thee, my blessed Savior. I surrender.
Truly, today is the day that the Lord has made. So let us continue to rejoice and be glad in this day. We're grateful for our media ministry. We're grateful for Minister Renee, and thank you for our entire team for the worship and praise. Thank you for all of those who play behind the scenes. Thank you, Sister Lakeitha. Thank you, Bishop of Videography. We thank each and every one of you, our virtual followers and friends. It is indeed a pleasure to be able to come and celebrate God with you this Sunday morning, this fifth Sunday of May. Man, we're almost a couple of days away from the month of June. And I'm so excited about what God is doing because the month of June, at the end of the month of June, it will be 8 years that God has allowed me to pastor this congregation here now locally, but also some of you virtually. And I thank God for that opportunity. We all know that 8 is the number of new beginnings. And I know that God is doing a new movement. There is a shift taking place in my ministry, a shift taking place in my life. And I'm grateful for what God is doing, what God has done, and certainly for what God is about to do. We are thankful for our leading lady. Thank God for leading Lady Baker this morning, for all of our beautiful children and our grandbaby. We thank God for all of you and your families. Let's dig into the word of the Lord this morning. I won't be before you long. I just want to preach for you strong, but I won't be before you long. So if you help me preach it, we can reach it. I want for you to go with me to the book of Daniel. For the next couple of weeks, or however God, long God puts it on my heart to preach, we're going to preach from the book of Daniel, the life of Daniel. We're going to look at the amazing life of Daniel. So I want you to go with me to Daniel 1, the first chapter, Daniel 1, the first chapter. And when you get to Daniel, although we'll be going through the first chapter, just reading through these verses, I want you to go to Daniel. And I want you to look at the 20th verse. That's where we're going to get our reading from today. Daniel, the first chapter. And we're going to be looking at the 20th verse. I'm reading the Christian Standard Bible, but I'm also going to be juggling between the Christian Standard Bible and some of the Message Bible because I want to be able to bring the Word of God to you very clear. And this is what the 20th verse has to say. In every matter of wisdom and understanding that the king consulted them about, he found them 10 times better than all of the magicians and mediums in his entire kingdom. In all of them, he found them 10 times better. I want to, for the sake of these next preaching minutes, I want to be able to expound on this topic, living 10 times better. Living 10 times better. Brothers and sisters, if we can be honest with each other this morning, we've all found ourselves in some predicaments in life where we've had to make a decision. Do I do the right thing or do I take a chance at doing something wrong and just basically I'm going to accept what comes with my decisions? Life is just a series of decisions. Life is a group of decisions. You make decisions when you're younger. You make decisions when you're toddler. You make decisions infantry. You make decisions as a teenager, in your adolescent years. You make decisions in your collegiate years. You make decisions as adults. But depending on what decisions you make, it tells about how our life starts to turn out. And so in life, we, as we grow and as we mature, we start to make better decisions. But I believe if you would be honest with me this morning, all of us, if not all of us, at some point of our life have made some decisions that we kind of regret. We've made some decisions that we wish we can go back and kind of change the hands of time. We wish we could go back and change those decisions that we made when certain relationships, those decisions that we made on our job, the decision that we made to falsify some data, some decision that we made to put incorrect information on my resume. Hey, man, y'all talk to me this morning. Hey, man, you know, some of our resumes, if you have somebody else to read, they say, I don't even know who this is. But we made these decisions. Man, we've compromised our integrity. You know, the integrity, true integrity of a Christian, of a believer, is not so much what people see you do every day. It's knowing what God sees you do when nobody else is around. The true integrity of a Christian, of a believer, is what do you do when there is no one else around, when no one else can see what you're doing, no one else can hear what you're saying, no one else can see what you're thinking. True integrity of a believer is one that says, no matter what situation I get in, no matter what kind of issue come in my life, I'm not going to compromise my relationship with Jesus Christ. All of us, brothers and sisters, have been tempted. We have been put in some situations that have made us, amen, not made us, but have placed us in a situation where it will make us have to make a decision. Do I do what's right or do what I do what's wrong? I know growing up, you would see the cartoons. Many of us seen the cartoons when you're growing up. There was a picture. There was a picture of the devil on one side and there was an angel on the other side. There was a picture, amen, that was pretty much saying that in both your ears, you always have, amen, evil speaking, you have good speaking. And in our life, we have positive and we have negative. But I want to come and suggest through the life of Daniel today that if we're going to live 10 times better, we have to learn how to stay committed to our life that's pleasing to God rather than that's pleasing to our flesh. Can you just be honest with me this morning? Amen. Some of the things you do, you didn't do it, amen, because it did not feel good. You didn't drink it because it did not taste good. You didn't smoke it because it did not leave you a good feeling. You did these things because they contributed to a natural feeling that you were looking for, regardless if it was a feeling sexually or a feeling, amen, by way of drinking alcohol, a feeling by way of smoking some type of, amen, marijuana or a cigar, whatever it is, you did these things to get you in a feeling, to get you in a place or get you in a mood. Some of us, if you be true with yourself this morning, you did those things because you're running from something. Amen. But in the midst of making these decisions, are you compromising your relationship with God? Is it worth your relationship with God? Is it worth the people that you're, amen, allowing to suffocate your praise? Is it, amen, worth your relationship with God? Is it worth your relationship with God to, amen, smoke yourself to death, to drink yourself to death? Is it worth and compromising your relationship with God? Well, when we look at the life of Daniel, there are a couple things I want to point out to you, because if we're going to live a life that's 10 times better, there are some commitments that we have to make in our life. Somebody shout commitment. When we look at the text of Daniel, because number one, Daniel, in the first 6 chapters of Daniel, it tells about Daniel's life. In the first chapter of Daniel, Daniel goes through, amen, a very serious situation. He goes through a very serious transition in his life. Daniel, in this particular chapter, we notice in the first verse that Daniel, amen, in the 3rd year of reign of King Jehoiakim, here it is, Daniel, amen, is in captivity. We notice that King Nebuchadnezzar of Babylon declared war on Jerusalem and besieged the city. King Nebuchadnezzar would take over, but you got to understand that Babylon was a great, powerful, amen, city. It was a great, powerful entity. Facts about it, the only city that's named more than Babylon in the Bible is, guess what? You got it, Jerusalem. The second most noted name of any city in the Bible is Babylon. Babylon was that powerful of a city. Babylon would take over Jerusalem, and in the midst of taking over Jerusalem, Daniel and his 3 friends find themselves in captivity as some teenage boys. Can you imagine what's going on in the life of Daniel At the age of 10, of teenagers, he's been displaced away from his family, and now he's having to be in captivity. He's no longer around those that he know, but he's around those who are, amen, strangers to him. He's no longer around what he's familiar with. He has to learn to praise God in the midst of what he's unfamiliar with. Can I just talk to a few of you this morning? Because if you're going to live a life that's 10 times better, you've got to learn how to stay committed to God, even in unfamiliar territories, even around strangers, even around places that you didn't even ask to be in. You've got to learn how to trust in God. Daniel will show us that no matter what situation he was in, he learned how to trust the Lord. Is that your testimony this morning? If so, I dare you to just type down in the comment field that I've learned how to trust God in no matter what situation I'm in. Daniel says, he says, now I've been kidnapped. I've been kidnapped in a situation that I'm even asked to be in. How many of you can attest this morning that you've been in situations sometimes that you didn't even ask to be in? You didn't even ask to be in the situation you're in, but still be to God this morning that you have stayed faithful to him in the midst of your situation. Daniel says, and maybe you're saying this morning, I didn't ask for death to hit my family. I didn't ask for trials to hit my family. I didn't ask for tragedy to hit my family. But thank be to God, no matter what has come my way, I have a mindset like Daniel that I'm going to still trust him and I'm going to praise him in spite of, in the midst of circumstances. Can you give God a praise this morning that no matter what it looks like, no matter how many tragedies have come, no matter how much the flood has come, no matter how many storms have come in your life and in your relationships, you made it your commitment that you will not compromise your relationship with God and you will continue to be faithful to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. The Bible tells us right here in the second verse, the master handed the king Jehoiakim over Judah, over to him along with some of the furnishings. These individuals, Daniel and his friends, amen, were from the tribe of Judah. If anybody know anything about the word of God, the tribe of Judah, amen, means the tribe of praise. These were some connected individuals. These were some individuals that had a worship about themselves. These individuals had a relationship with God. Can I tell you, sometimes the reason why individuals that go to church can make it through situations is because there's a difference between just being a church member versus having relationship with God. Daniel said, I have relationship with God. No matter if I'm over in Jerusalem, if I'm in Judah and I'm free, or if I'm over in Babylon and I'm captive. He says, no matter what the circumstance is, Daniel says, I've learned how to trust and to praise God. Come here with your sanctified self this morning. In other words, Daniel says, I've learned how to give him praises when everything looks right, but I've also learned how to give him glory when everything is going wrong. He says, I've learned how to trust God in the midst of sickness, but I've also learned how to give him praises when I'm feeling well. He says, I've learned how to love and give God appreciation when I have money, but I also know how to call his name when I don't. Daniel says, no matter what circumstance I'm in, I wish y'all would shout with me this morning, no matter what circumstance I'm in, I'm going to learn how to continue to trust God. Here it is. He is a captain of Babylon. He's now in Babylon, and King Nebuchadnezzar have made some instructions he put in place. You got to understand why it's important that these individuals that come from a tribe of Judah, which means praise, because they understood that because of being some praisers, there's sometimes you've got to praise your way through. Sometimes you got to praise your way through the stresses of this world. Sometimes you got to praise your way through what we see happening with our government. Sometimes you got to praise your way through when you see so many murders and so many car robberies and so many thefts taking place in a Atlanta. You got to praise your way through. Even when you see hell coming in at your address, you got to praise your way through. When death hits your family, you got to praise your way through. When trials come your way, because when you are connected with God, there's a praise on the inside. Somebody shout, I got a praise on the inside. Daniel says, here it is, I am a captive, I'm a prisoner, I've been kidnapped from my home. Well, what do you do when you are no longer in your familiar territories, New Mount Calvary? Can I shout with you? If we're going to be a church that's 10 times better, you got to learn how to be comfortable and still praise God. Watch this, in unfamiliar territories. God may not always leave us in our Jerusalem, our Concord. Okay, talk to me, God. I hear you speaking. He says, sometimes I have to take you outside of Concord, outside of your comfort zone. It may feel like you're not used to this. It may not feel, he said, but in the midst of what doesn't feel comfortable, you got to learn how to still trust me and praise me in spite of. Can I tell you something? Could it be that Daniel would have never made it to chapters 3, 4, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6 if Daniel had never been through chapter 1? Can I help y'all? Sometimes you're trying to avoid the chapters that God have placed in your life because you don't like the way the chapter looked. Daniel could not avoid going through captivity. Daniel could not avoid having to stand before Nebuchadnezzar. Can I tell you? There are some trials and tribulations that you will not be able to avoid. And God is saying, if you can get through your chapter one, woo! I've got some chapter twos and some threes. He says, if you can get through your chapter one, I'll get you through a fiery furnace. If you can get through to your chapter one, I'll even get you through the lion's den. Is there anybody who can attest this morning? Thank be to God that in the midst of my chapter that I'm going through right now, I'm determined that I'm going to make it to where God will have me to be. Come here, talk to me, Daniel, so I can get out of here. I told the bishop I won't be long this morning, but I feel my help coming. And whenever my help comes, I don't have no control over this time thing. But anyway, here it is. He says, I see me, King Nebuchadnezzar took the furnishings to the country of Babylon, the ancient Shinar. He put the furnishings in the sacred treasure. The king told Ashpenaz, head of the palace staff, to get some Israelites from the royal family and nobility. Get some young men who were healthy and handsome, intelligent, and well-educated, good prospects for leadership positions in government, some perfect specimens, and indoctrinate them in the Babylonian language and lore of magic and fortune-telling. Ooh. In other words, it is King one of the best of those that they have placed in captivity. He wanted the best of these young men. He wanted them with no blemishes. He wanted them with, amen, no physical defection. He wanted the best of them, which tells me that when he got Daniel and his friends, they were in good health. They were in a good place. They were good mentally. But you got to understand that even though they was in a good place mentally, they was in a good place mentally based upon Jerusalem, based upon, amen, Israel. But he wanted to break the Israel mentality to give them a Babylonian mentality. He wanted to break their idea of their God and introduce them to his God. But I wish I had some people in here that can attest, no matter what kind of friends I go around, I can hang out with my girlfriends, but I'm going to still trust my God. I could go out with my homeboys, but I'm still going to trust my God. Daniel says, no matter where I am, Jerusalem, or if I'm in Babylonia, if I'm in Babylon, it does not matter because I know who my God is. But this is what they try to do, because this is what the world will do to you. Understand, if you want to take anyone knowledge from them, erase their history. If you want to take anyone knowledge away from them, erase their history. That's why it bothers me so much that so many African Americans, we are so heartbroken over slavery, but we forget to rejoice over being kings and queens. Slavery is not our only past. Slavery is not our only history. Slavery is just a part of our history. But can I tell you, For go past 300-400 years, we come from DNA of kings, DNA of queens, DNA of warriors, DNA of people who build pyramids. When you look into your DNA, if they remove your history, remove your DNA, you will forget how powerful it is. Quit letting people remove your DNA, because once you do that, you lose your history. You forget how powerful you are. Can I talk to five people this morning that say, when I stepped out of the bed and my foot hit the ground, I recognized I had the DNA of folk who built pyramids. When I stepped out of bed this morning, my feet hit the ground. I had the DNA of kings and the DNA of queens. You've got to make a decision this morning. Are you going after the DNA of your kings and your queens and the ones who can build pyramids, or do you want to take the mentality of the DNA of those who were enslaved? I believe that they were trying to break the mindset of David and his friends, because they understood if we're really going to get what we want out of them, we got to break their mentality. We got to get them to change their identity. Uh-oh, how many of you have been going through an identity crisis? You don't really know who you are. You take on the identity and the DNA of social media. Anything that changes, it changes you. But there ought to be some people that says, I know who I am in Christ Jesus. I know who my God is. I know who my Savior is. It doesn't matter what they try to strip me from. They can't strip me away from my relationship with Jesus Christ. They says, change their language to our language. Get them to talk how we talk. Ain't it strange how many people say they're Christians, and instead of getting the world to sound like them, they sound more and more like the world. King Nebuchadnezzar said, change them. Because if they're gonna be well the way I need them to be, I need you to break them. The enemy wants to break you down so he can change your talk, he can change your behavior. But Daniel and the boy says, listen, doesn't matter what they do to us, they may change our names, they may even change where we live, they may even change our location, but they will not change our faith. They will not change who we trust. They will not change who we know who is the true and living God. Understand something, because they wanted to change their name. David's name in the Hebrew meant God is my judge. Hananiah's name in the Hebrew meant Yahweh is gracious. Mishael's name in Hebrew meant who what God is. Ananiah's name, amen, in the Greek meant Yahweh is help. All of their names were connected to understanding who God is. And so the only way they thought that they can break them was to change their name. If we change their name, we can disconnect them from God. But they didn't understand that changing my name won't change my heart. Oh man, y'all help me this morning, because sometimes people may want to call you different things, but it doesn't matter what you call me. I know in my heart I'm connected with Jesus Christ. You can call me Pastor Q, you can call me Reverend Baker, you can call me Lil Quinn, you can call me QB from back in the day. It doesn't matter what you call me. I know who I am in my heart, because once you've been born again and saved by the blood of Jesus Christ, God gives you a new name anyway. I wish there was somebody who could attest, since I've been born again, I've been given a new name. I've been given, amen, he says you become heirs and joint heirs of the kingdom. I'm now, amen, a born again family member of Jesus Christ. So you can call me what you want to call me. Oh, somebody say thank be to God this morning. You can look at me how you want to look at me. You can take me from Jerusalem and put me over in Babylon. You can take me from Lithonia and put me in McDonough. You can take me from Georgia and put me in California. But what you can't do is take me out of the love of Jesus Christ, because there's nothing that can separate me, woo, from the love of Jesus Christ. Here it is. So they try to strip them of everything they knew, try to strip them of their history, try to strip them down, break them down. But because they were so strong in their faith, they could not break Daniel and his friends down. The king told Ashpenaz, he said, listen, head of the palace staff, he said, listen, I need you to go get some Israelites, go get these boys. And look who they went for. Young men, and handsome and intelligent, and well-educated. Look who they went for. They didn't go after the ones that were looking slack, the ones that were high, the ones that was out in the street. They went for the best of the best. Can I tell you, if you're going to do anything in your life, if they come for me, I want them to come for the best of the best. If when the enemy comes for you, he comes for the best of the best. Don't get so upset when things happen in your life. Just know that the enemy is coming for the best of the best. When the enemy comes for you, the enemy says, I'm going for the cream of the crop. I'm going for those who are educated. I'm going for those who are intelligent. Look at them, healthy and handsome. Sometimes we get all bent out of portion, but you ought to be glad to know that if the enemy is coming for you, that means that you have made it to some arrival that's close to where God will have you to be. He says, go get them that are young, those who are strong, those who are vibrant. Go get them those who look good. He's saying, when you get them, listen, I want you to teach them our ways. I want you to teach them how we do things. But listen, Daniel determined and him and his friends that they were not going to bow to what the king was trying to get them to transition into. But can I tell you one thing about I like about the text, because we can't move past this point so quick, because although they understood who their identity was, they wasn't going through an identity crisis. Neither did they experience identity fraud, because some of us, not only do we go through an identity crisis, but some of us experience identity fraud. Which means instead of letting somebody encourage you, empower you, you try to steal everything about them, and you never live out your passion, your dream. I see it all the time in ministry. Instead of being the pastor that God would call you to be, you're too busy trying to be like your senior pastor. You're too busy trying to be like your uncle. You're too busy trying to be like your grandfather. But what about who God has called you to be? That's called identity theft. When God has given you something, an assignment to walk in, you have to walk in the assignment that God has called you, because if you're walking in anybody else's shoes, that's called identity theft. Most people experience identity theft because they went through an identity crisis. An identity crisis is not knowing who you are. But Daniel says, I know exactly who I am, and because I know who I am, I don't have an identity crisis, and because I don't have an identity crisis, I'm not going to experience identity theft. Identity theft is taking along who they want me to be. I don't have to be who anybody else want me to be. Can I suggest to you, if you're going to live 10 times better, you got to live who God has called you to be. Sometimes that's not comfortable for family. Sometimes that's not comfortable for friends. But if you're going to live 10 times better, you got to live according to what God has called you to be. And sometimes when God calls you to be somebody and has an assignment for your life, it's very different from what the people around you want. Watch this. Says, and the king ordered that they may be served from the same menu, captured in bondage, but get to eat at the king's table. They was captured, they were slave in bondage, but then they get to eat at the king's table. This is kind of strange to Daniel and the boys, because they never ate at this level of tables. Oh, y'all stay with me. They've never been in these kind of rooms. They've never been around this kind of company. But can I tell you something? Be careful of compromising because of your company. Be very careful of compromising because of your company. Because so many times when we get a chance to sit at certain tables, we get a chance to get into the presence of certain people, we start compromising our relationship with God because of the company that we're in. But can I suggest to you, even if you sit at the table with executives at CBS, even if you sit at the table with executives at the next record label, even if you sit at the table with somebody from the real estate agent, even if you sit at the table from the governor or the mayor, even if you sit at the table with the president, don't compromise because of the company that you're in. Woo! I wish I had some real witnesses out there. And too many of us in the body of Christ, we compromise who Christ is contingent upon the company that we're in. But I wish I had five people who can shout, I don't care if I'm in corporate America. I'm not compromising my God. I don't care if I'm out with entertainers. I'm not compromising my God. I shall not compromise because of the company I'm in. My time is getting short. Let me get ready to get up out of here. But listen, here it is. He says, you got to eat what we eat. Now the boy said, no. This is how we're going to do this. This is exactly how we're going to do this. Daniel says, we're not going to eat what you give us. I'm not going to drink what you give us. Now, Astronauts got a little finicky. He said, man, you don't understand what kind of position you're trying to put me in. They said, no, listen, what we'll do, we're just going to eat vegetables and drink water. They said, we're not going to eat none of your fine meat. You got to be careful, because if you want to live 10 times better, you got to be careful from eating from everybody's table. You got to be careful from being fed from everybody's knowledge. You've got to be careful from being fed from everybody's counsel. You know, I've never seen in my life, I'm 43 years strong, and here it is. Everybody now is a relationship expert. How do we get so many relationship experts and the divorce rate is increasing? Y'all help me now. You cannot feed from everybody's knowledge, because everybody's knowledge doesn't mean it's wisdom. You cannot feed from everybody's understanding. You can't. They say we don't want that food because that's that sacrificial food. And they had this. They had good meat out of Java. They had steaks, well, medium well. Oh man, I could see the juice coming out the steaks. Man, nice grilled marsh. They had yard bird. They had yard bird out there. Chickens had done that they might live. They had some salmon. They had oysters. They had shrimp. They had such a nice spread. But Daniel said, we don't want none of that. Wouldn't it be something if you knew how to turn down things that look good to you, but ain't no good for you? Woo, I got to get ready to get out of here. Because God is saying to you today, if you're going to live 10 times better, you got to learn how to turn down some things that looks good to the world. You got to learn how to reject some things. You got to learn how to push some stuff to the side. Daniel the boy says, man, we don't want none of that stuff because we refuse to eat from your table because you're trying to turn us into something that God would not have us to be. Wouldn't it be something if you learn how to turn away from stuff that look good to you, but ain't no good for you? Oh, brothers and sisters, I got to really get up out of here. We'll jog through Daniel. But Daniel ends up not eating the king's food. He said he agreed with them that they would test him for 10 days. He said, because if y'all don't eat, man, y'all going to look crazy. There's people that's feeling like if you don't listen to them, your life ain't going to work out right. There's people right now that feel like if you don't do it their way, it won't work out. But Daniel said, we're going to trust in God. There's people saying, well, if you don't do it by this way, if you don't do it how somebody else do it, then it ain't right. But Daniel says, that ain't how we're going to do this. I'm going to fully trust in God. Are you in a season in your life that you're going to fully trust in God, or are you willing to just eat from anyone's table? Daniel said, no, give us 10 days. And they agreed with them on the 10 days and test them. And at the end of 10 days, Bible says they look better and healthier than all the young men who were eating the king's food. Woo. Can you see Nebuchadnezzar saying, what kind of foolishness? You know how jealous folk people get with you when your way worked better than their way? Have you ever seen family members and people get, because they just knew you weren't going to make it, but you did. They just knew your marriage wasn't going to make it, but it did. They just knew you weren't going to get healed, but you are. They just knew you weren't going to. I wish I had some people out here that understood if you just stay faithful to God. God has a way of working this thing out. It says they continued to remove their food and the wine they were to drink and gave them vegetables. And they looked better than the other men by eating differently from the way the king had set out for them. Can I tell you, if you're going to live better, sometimes you just have to be committed to doing things differently than what people are saying you should do it. Sometimes the way that people want you to do it is not the way that God wants you to do it. But it says God gave these four young men knowledge and understanding in every kind of literature and wisdom. They were strong, wise, smart men. And Daniel also understood visions and dreams of every kind. And in a time, the king said to President, the chief eunuch, he said to Nebuchadnezzar, the king interviewed them, and among all of them, no one was found equal to Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. So they began to attend the king in every matter of wisdom and understanding that the king consulted them about. He found them 10 times better. than all the magicians and mediums in the entire kingdom. Daniel remained there until the first year of King Cyrus. Because they stayed faithful, they were found to be 10 times better than those who ate from the king's table. Are you looking to live a life that's 10 times better? In order to do so, you can't compromise in this season. I know it looks good over there. I want to go over there and eat too, but guess what? God is preparing the table before my enemies. You think it looks better over there, but don't you compromise. Don't compromise to go with this crew. Don't compromise to hang in that company. Don't compromise, watch this, to be accepted in other groups. Sometimes the best walk you can walk is walk by yourself. Because guess what? Even when physically it looks like you're alone, God says, I'm always with you. If I never leave you, never shall I forsake you. And the reason why Daniel then was blessed, because the Bible tells us that I've never seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed beg bread. You want to live 10 times better? Stay faithful to God. Don't compromise. Know your identity of who God is. Be careful from where you feed from, and God will reward you for your faithfulness. God bless you. We love you. This is Pastor Q. We'll see you next time. Until then, peace.
Thank you for joining us today. I'm sure you've truly been blessed with the word. If you would like to become a member of the NMC family, please use the email below. If you didn't have the opportunity to give, you can give by using the information below. And again, thank you for this experience. And come join us again. You be blessed. Thank you.
Come on, put your hands together as we get ready to leave today. I hope you enjoyed the message. I hope God blessed you. I want you to put your hands together and dance a little bit with me. Come on. To the left. To the right. Come on. Hey. To the left. To the right. Come on. Take it back. To the come on. Take it back. Come on. To the left. Listen. If it had cannot be for the Lord on my side, tell me where would I be? Oh, where would I? Come on, hey, hey, where would I be? Where would you be? Where would I be if